The machine's on. No title. Take one. Here we go.
Well,
CL62-291. Number two. Take
wait
one.
Wait 1 minute.
Two days in the spring of 1959, after a string of critically acclaimed and successful albums, Miles Davis recorded what would become Kind of Blue. Nothing would ever be the same, for jazz or for Miles Davis.
It is one of the single greatest achievements in recorded music.
It's a cornerstone record, not only for jazz, it's a cornerstone record for music.
Everybody knows Kind of Blue, and that because they have heard enough songs from this disc, they just hit these images in their head, I think, of what this title means for them.
I put on So What while I was going to Temple University. Every morning, the alarm clock went off, I hit the alarm clock, and then I pressed the button, and the record dropped.
Sort of like, you know, the Bible in a way. You know, you just have one in your house.
I think I had about 3 copies. I got the records, you know, the albums, real albums.
How do you go to the studio with it's minimum stuff and you come out with eternity?
There is one record, I mean, we've all said it, but it's really true, that captures the essence of jazz for a variety of reasons. It would have to be Kind of Blue.
When we did this Kind of Blue thing, I thought that was special too, but not as special as it got to be. Yeah, I didn't expect it would be the top-selling jazz record of all time.
In the 50s, jazz was a ubiquitous presence in New York City. Clubs were thriving from Greenwich Village to Harlem.
There used to be a thing in Birdland where the players used to come because, you know, they would have Count Basie's band in there for a couple of weeks, and the place would be like a Hollywood extravaganza, you know, like the players would pull up in their Cadillacs and leave them parked up out and get out with their honeys and go downstairs in Birdland, you know.
I think in the 50s, jazz was coming into its own as an art music. In New York, you could find jazz all over the place. The downtown club scene was flourishing.
Jazz was everywhere. You know, everywhere, I mean, it was on TV a couple of times a month, you know, and there was in the newspapers and in magazines, so.
The music was at a great time. Like, it was everybody that you knew that played an instrument, you could tell who they were, you know, just by the sound. It was just a hard swinging, playing bebop tunes, a lot of changes, and, you know, the horn players were playing a lot of changes and things like that.
I was a teenager in the 50s, and we were very much into the doo-wop groups, you know, the Bird groups, the Ravens, the Orioles. That was our music, Frankie Lyman and the Teenagers. But jazz was always there, because in my house, that's what you grew up with your parents listening to. Duke Ellington, Count Basie. But they were elements of my parents' music and not mine. But at some point, you made that transition from not going from one to the other, but opening the door to another. I never went away from rhythm and blues, but I brought jazz into my tent.